Lord, and that you will anoint our pastor, Lord, as he will share with us what you have shared with him. And Lord, we together, corporately, will press together ahead and to reach the goal that you set before us. And we've come to worship you and to bless your name. Let's praise him. Let's worship him together.
Worthy to be praised. Oh, come magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. We sing Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Oh, come magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Oh, come magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. We sing Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. I will call upon the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Oh, I will call upon the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. We sing Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Oh, come magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Oh, come magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. We sing Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock of my salvation.
He is my rock. He is the rock of my salvation. I have a firm foundation when I put my life on the rock, and I'm thankful for that this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Where do I go when there's nobody else to turn to? Who do I talk to? Oh, and nobody wants to listen. Who do I lean on? When there's no foundation stable, I go to the rock. I know he's able. I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. Oh, and the earth.
give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. We're going to sing that verse, of course, again. That second verse asked the question, is there a refuge? And it just kind of swelled up inside of me that quickly. And I'm reminded of Psalms 46 and 1. I have an answer for that song. God is our refuge and strength. Can somebody say amen for that this morning? A very present help in trouble. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Let's sing it again.
Salvation, I go to the stone that the builders reject. Oh, I run to the mountain and the mountains and crying. Oh, when the earth all around me is sinking sand, oh, Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Oh, where do I go?
He's Jesus Messiah. He's the name above all names. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for who you are.
Jesus Messiah. Humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. His love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, my blessed Redeemer. He's my Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners. He's the ransom from heaven. Oh, Jesus Messiah, oh Lord of all.
Poured out all for love, the whole earth
trembled and the veil was torn. Oh, love so amazing. Oh, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, He's the name above all names. My blessed Redeemer.
This building, let's just take a moment and worship the Lord this morning. Father, we're thankful for your Son today, thankful for Messiah, thankful, Lord, that He still has the name that is above all names this morning, that name by which men can be saved. Lord, thank you for your presence, thank you for what I feel in my soul, thank you, Lord, for the moving of the Spirit of God in our hearts and in our lives this morning. Lord, just help us throughout this service. We'll forever give you praise, honor, and glory for it. In the sweet, lovely name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody just said a big old amen. Amen. Shake your neighbor by the hand. Greet them in the name of the Lord and bring them to the choir. Let's fill up this platform this morning.
I tell you, I didn't realize, actually, we were talking about singing this song 2 weeks ago because we didn't get to have choir last Sunday for the adults. Didn't realize, hadn't studied it at the time, the Sunday school lesson, how this really went to along with it, this song does. But so did the choruses today. Jesus Messiah, He is our rock. He is our only way.
Amen.
Amen. So this morning, let's sing this victory today is mine.
There's a deep, still peace abiding in my heart.
you claim it this morning? For greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And I'm going to put the old devil right under my feet. Amen. He'll stick his head out, but I'll keep stomping him. And I know that I have victory. For the scriptures we taught this morning, that sin shall not have dominion over us. Sin shall not rule over us, because we have the King of Kings that is our ruler. Amen. We welcome each one of you. I feel good this morning. I feel like my get up and go wants to get up and go. Let's go. I'm ready for the vision and get ready for what God's got for us. And if you have your bulletins, get them out and welcome all our first-time guests. We're so glad to have you. Bulletins at a glance, events that's going on. Let's not forget, tomorrow night is our business meeting. And if you support this local church with your tithes and with your coming and your giving, all that you do, we invite you to be here to hear what has happened and where our finances is going, the ministry, what God is doing through the ministry of the Ocoee Church of God. So 7 o'clock, let's be here in our quarterly business meeting. Then Thursday, well, we have Wednesday night meals. You can look at that. But Thursday night at 7 o'clock, our women's discipleship will be having their class meeting. Then something special is taking place on Saturday at 5 o'clock. Brother Ashbury, don't forget to ask your girlfriend about Saturday night. I'm going to bring my bride, our Valentine's and party. And if you don't have a spouse, or just bring a friend, because we're going to just fellowship and have a good time. Those are preparing this. Be sure to get your tickets. Now, Saturday, you get your tickets today and or tonight. And I guess we can get them at the door also. But it's $10 for the adult. And you'll enjoy the fellowship we always have and the food. And just a good time. And that we can love on one another, because we should be doing that every day, because of the love of Jesus Christ. God bless you, Pastor.
Do you love the Lord this morning? Amen. Valentine's banquet is Saturday. And we're going to have a great meal. This year I have been a little more hands-off than in years past. There's enough of these other folks. They've got it all planned out. They sent me an email, somebody did, with a list of things everybody had to do. I had one task on it. I responded, I will take care of my one to-do item. And then after I thought about that email and did a little more chatting, I thought, I better respond on a few more of these things. So I sent another email and said, well, I think you should do this, and maybe you should think about this, and what about that? And nobody has responded that I know of. And that was like Wednesday of the week. So those of you that got that email, I'm waiting for a response. Amen? Amen. But we're playing a great time. They'll have the door prizes on Saturday night. And you'll have your 10 opportunities to go for door prizes. A great meal. They're doing candy grams. I'm not sure they're called candy grams. But they're doing that type of event. And we'll have those. And rumor has it we're just going to have a fine time in the Lord. That'll be Saturday night, 5 o'clock. And you don't have to have a date. I guess you can come solo. I've been encouraging the young people around here. Girls don't ask boys. But I told the girls this week, I said, if you got somebody special you really want to ask you, if you'll come put a bug in my ear, I'll put that bug in the boys' ear. And but we're trying to help them, and they need to do it the right way. And some of these young guys and girls are going together as an item this coming weekend. I know there's a couple of relationships that are I don't want to say the word growing. I'll just say they're together today. And so I'll ask the girl, and I'll say, has so-and-so asked you to the No, I'll say something like, aren't you so-and-so and so-and-so together? Aren't you on item? Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. And they get all, has he asked you to the banquet yet? No, sir. I said, well, there's a problem there. He's supposed to. I'm assuming he would ask the individual that
he is calling his friend right now, and I said, I'll have to work on that, so that I'll go find the boy and say, I understand you haven't asked your friend that's a girl to the banquet yet. Are you bringing someone else to the banquet? And so I have been known to stir the pot. I get it from Michael Renfro, and I think the direct quote is, I wouldn't want to get anything started now, would I? And we're going to have a great time on Saturday night, not Friday night. I will be dead again Friday night, but Saturday night we will do this. It's early enough. We can get in here, have a great time. When it's over, we'll tear down and set back up for Sunday. It won't be too late. So if you know you're coming, just go buy your ticket today. And don't stress me out this week, because they want to go spend money and buy gifts and food. And my question will be, well, how many tickets have you sold? And then they'll say, well, you know how those Ocoee folks are. We don't buy tickets till the last day of anything. I'm thinking, yeah, I know. And you stress a pastor out. That's why I have gray hair. Amen. But we're going to have a great time. It is open to whosoever will. And so if you have friends that want to come with you, or acquaintances, somebody that needs to get connected with church, but they may not come to a Sunday service, what a great way. I believe it'll be proper. I believe you'll be pleased with it. To bring them on Saturday night, introduce them, let them realize the building won't fall down when they walk on the property. Amen. I've heard it all in pastoring. So going to have a great time on Saturday night, 5 o'clock. Let me take just a few moments and just update you. Thank you for being flexible in our parking lot this morning. And I was out there early and tried to help a few folks. And I know some have double parked over here, and we've got 8 or 9 or 12 parked in the back 40, we call it. If you will give me one more Sunday, no more than two more Sundays, we will have that, Lord willing, all corrected. And there'll be 10 parking spots in addition to the 3 we've covered up. Right up this way, we'll give you some more room. If you'll just please be flexible. And when you do things like this, people get frustrated and don't understand why. It really wasn't my decision, but I guess it kind of was. When we put a building in, we covered up some parking, so I had to replace that parking. And the years of just putting a parking stopper out there and saying, there it is, those days are gone. So we have to make a drive path and put a concrete apron and be a good neighbor with the county. So just please be flexible with us. If you are able, I asked all leadership Monday night and staff, if I walk that parking lot while you're taking your offering, giving your offering, and I see your car in that parking lot, I'm going to write you a parking ticket this morning. Amen. Now we need to park out in the back 40 and give our other folks that need to be closer a little extra room in these coming days as we're trying to get through this project. Do want to say thank you for last weekend. What a wonderful time. The youth did a phenomenal job last weekend. The guest speaker was great. Sunday night was great. I had church all over this weekend. Amen. It was a wonderful weekend. I'm thankful for that. And tomorrow night, our business meeting. Today, Envision, I'll explain a little bit more. I won't give you a lot of details today. I can't. But some of those details we will get into tomorrow night. So just plan to be with us tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, as we discuss the finances of your church. Brother Rex called me. Actually, he called me yesterday. I was supposed to tell you, so I'll tell you now. Brother Rex called me and said that he's coming home next month. I said, well, about time. We're missing you. Amen. And he says, I've had enough snow. I've had enough days without the sun. He said, 18-degree weather is just not for me. I'm coming home, and I don't think I ever want to come back up here. And so he asked, we were traveling back yesterday. I was in one van. Miss Wendy was in a different van. And he did ask that I send you his love. And he said, will you let the church know that I love them and I miss them and thank you for praying for him? And I said I would do that. So I wanted to take care of that this morning. We had a wonderful Friday and Saturday. Sister Wendy and I, along with Principal Smith and Coach Rob and a couple student helpers, loaded up 2 vans. And in our insanity, we took 13 8 to 12-year-olds, okay, to Fort Pierce, Florida, stayed 2 nights in a hotel, had to shuttle clothes and shuttle people, and they spent all day Friday competing, giving their very best unto the Lord, and a service Friday night. We had to compete some more after church Friday night because the day just ran long, and then Saturday was awards. We would hold all of those medals, and we would present them in Sunday services and hold them and present them in chapel. It's just, we just can't, it's too big. We can't do it that way anymore. So let me just give you the highlights. We took 13 students. We came home with 50 individual medals. Can you say amen for that? Amen. The largest group that we had ever taken to juniors. I remember, I was telling staff this, I remember when we took 12 to 15 kids to the older event. We're going to have about 30 of them going in just a few months. But I remember when 12 to 15 was what we had in the older classes. And this year we took 13 down to the junior side. It would have been 16 and we would have had a couple more helpers. But as many of you know, Pastor Dustin, Sister Holly's grandpa passed away. So they were away. And I want to say on behalf of them, thank you for your prayers, your messages, your texts to them, your Facebook post, and I was with them on Thursday for the service. It had a wonderful going away service for our brother Suggs, and as we were singing that song this morning, victory is his and victory is ours, amen, and I'm looking forward to seeing him again in heaven. So just a wonderful weekend, but I do want to say thanks to staff. There's been a lot of people working behind the scenes, and there's five different main categories, and they do give school awards for the first, second, and third place schools that have the most awards, if you will, individual awards in those categories. And our school, our little school on the side of Lakewood, that brought home 50 medals, also collectively placed third place overall in the music category. Can you say amen for that? And that was phenomenal. And those kids have been practicing and singing, and Miss Wendy's like, we're going to try to rope us in an extra piano player this year. And so I took Ryan with us. I said, well, you come play convention. He's been coming to practices, and Cherry helped with a small ensemble. We call it a junior youth choir. They call it a small. We just had a wonderful time. So God's on the move. Amen. Amen. Not just on Sunday mornings, but every day of the week. We're seeing God do wonderful things, and I'm so thankful for that this morning. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer right now. There are many that are sick, some out with flu, some out with shingles, some out with some breathing issues, and there's just lots of sickness. I heard, I think Sister Renfro mentioned Colton this morning, just lots of things happening. And I want to just collectively, as the family of God, pray this morning that God will move on these requests. I do want to ask that you specifically pray for the Jenkins family. That was a request from Wednesday night. Last Monday morning on the way to school, Jenkins family, a mom and her three girls, was involved in a car accident right up here by the golf course. And they are still dealing with some of the effects of that. They're supposed to all be back in school tomorrow, is my understanding. We were able to be with them at the hospital. Pastor Dustin went and picked up the father who was at home. And so one car family, just a lot of dynamics this week. But more importantly, I want the Spirit of God just to touch their heart. I don't want to go into lots of details, but I will tell you, since that time and late Friday night, about midnight Friday night, I received a text from one of those members of that family just asking that we would pray for them because they want to know without a doubt that everything is right between them and the Lord. And I said, God, that's what this is about, helping people realize that they need more than anything have a right relationship with Jesus. Life is but a vapor. Can somebody say amen? Here today, gone tomorrow. But I know if I have Jesus, that victory will be mine. So I'm going to ask you, if you will, to stand this morning. And let's just take a moment, and I want to hear you pray. I want to hear you from the back to the front. I want us to pray specifically for the healings that need to take place amongst our church and our family. You have individual needs. Call upon God, and let's see what God will do. Father, we love you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the power of prayer. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege that we have on a Sunday morning to lift up the name of Jesus. Father, I don't ever want to take granted, Lord, the opportunity that we have to gather in the house of the Lord, to call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I don't ever want to take for granted the opportunity we have to pray, to lift up the name of Jesus. Father, I pray this morning that you will move upon every request. And Lord, those that are dealing with sickness, those that are dealing with flu and strep, God, and shingles and chest pains and sadness, God. Lord, I just know that you're able this morning to move on their life. And God, I know you're able this morning, Lord, to heal them from the inside out. Father, I thank you for what you've done around Ocoee. Thank you, Lord, for the blood of the Lamb that's effective. And thank you, Lord, for the call to ministry you've placed upon us. And Lord, and we believe that by your stripes we are healed. And we believe, God, that with God all things are still possible. Lord, and we bring these requests before you. Lord, touch those that are in the hospital. Touch those that are homebound. Touch those that are in rehab facilities. Touch those, God, that just need a touch in their life at their house this morning. Lord, and we just give you praise and honor and glory for who you are and what you're doing. Father, I know today that we serve a great big God. Lord, and I bring my little request to him. Believe he's able to move upon the little ones. Believe he's able to move upon the big ones. Lord, that Jesus will be lifted up through it all. Lord, and we'll forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for it. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray this morning. Everybody just said amen. And amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. It is good to have Sister Nola back. She had some eye surgery several days ago and out of state, and they're back today. Good to see her and Brother Charles, and good to see you this morning. Missed some of you last week, and I'm glad that you're back today. I do want to say it's good to have Brother Richard Sines with us. He is our resident that stays with us a couple months out of the year and lives way, way up north where it's real, real cold. I'll just say it that way. And has family here. And I walked out of the office building and saw a car with a tag that wasn't Florida. And his name popped in my mind. I thought that could be Brother Richard Sines. And sure enough, it was. I greeted him already. So good to have him. Are you excited about what God's doing? I am. I am just excited about what's happening around here. And if you went here Wednesday night, we received a temporary approval, a temporary CO to occupy building number 4. Can you say amen for that? And so while I was gone playing chaperone and pastor and whatever I did this weekend, there was a group of people that stayed after school Friday and even into yesterday and moved classrooms and set up classrooms and got everything ready. And so all 4 buildings will be occupied in the morning at 8:30 with the correct students in the right places. It's been a long few months coming, and we're thankful for that. And I'm looking forward to having a quiet office building for a few days. And if you're around here, you know those first graders are loud. They're just loud. First graders are just into everything, and I love them, but I'm glad they go home at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. But they will have their own building in the morning that they can go and do whatever they want to do in there. As loud they want to sing, they want to do sounds, if they want to clap, if whatever they want to do, they can do it all in Jesus' name, as long as it's not my building tomorrow. And then we use 2 of those buildings today. We've been using 1 for our college and career class, and as of today, we've moved another class out there. And so this morning, 2 of those buildings were used during our educational hour. And I'm just thankful for what God's doing. We basically added 1,000 square feet since last Sunday, and we've already begun to use that for the glory of the Lord, and I'm thankful for that today. So it's just been a good week, and I may be a little bit tired in body, but I feel pretty good in spirit. So you better watch out, because I'm going to preach here in just a few moments and then try to get us to a vision setting. Before I do that, we probably should receive tithes and offerings. I don't want you to miss a blessing, and I don't want the finance director coming after me. And I don't want to get to heaven, the Lord say, you didn't give those people an opportunity to give. They want to give because a Christian loves to give. Amen? And we're going to do that this morning, our tithes and our offerings. It is the first Sunday of the month. And so many of you will bring your first fruits on the first Sunday. Let's give all that belongs to him, knowing that he'll bless it. And I do thank you for your faithfulness. We only are able to do what we do because God's touched your heart and has asked you to partner with us. And I don't want to make light of that. I don't get up here and beat a whole lot about money. I probably could every week. Some people do. But I just have to have learned to trust the Lord. And sometimes that trust takes me a little deeper than maybe I'd like to take me. But I just have faith that he is God. And he will see us through. And this morning, let's give of our tithes, give of our offerings. And when the ushers reach the altar area, we'll ask God to bless it. God bless you as you give this morning. Thank you. Father, we love you this morning. Thank you for the privilege we've had to bring of our tithes and of our offerings to the storehouse. God, thank you for the promise, Lord, that's given in your word. Pray, God, that you'll now bless it, multiply it for its intended use, return it, Lord, in ways that you deem necessary, many folds, God, and we will forever give you praise, honor, and glory for it. In the name of Christ we ask, amen and amen. God bless you as you have given this morning. Thank you, musicians, for your time and your service unto the Lord this morning. I'm going to get right into the Word of the Lord today as it is Vision Sunday for us. And for any of our new families, if you weren't with us last year on Vision Sunday, this is something that we started many, many years ago, a chance for me to kind of preach from my heart and present to you some of the maybe tangible and ministry things that we can do to continue this path that God has given. I will tell you, this is not something that was thrown together an hour before church this morning, but hours and hours have went into this. And earlier this week on Monday night, I spent about 2 hours just in a setting with the leadership of this church and poured my heart out to them. And so I really want you to understand, this is not something I do to get off easy. It would probably be a little easier just to preach a regular sermon and have an altar call and go home. But my heart is, I want us to always have something in front of us, a vision that we have made very plain. That way we know where we're headed. And sometimes it's hard to communicate that when you have so much happening every single day and in ministry. But we do pause one Sunday of the year, and I try to do a condensed version. I kept the leadership meeting way longer than I intended, like 2 hours, 2.5 hours Monday night. And I'm not going to keep you that long. I'm very well aware of time. And I want to have lunch at some point this afternoon as well. So I'm going to give you the condensed version. Everything is not even going to be here, but we will go over more of it in detail tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. So if you'll let me preach just for a little bit, deliver what's before us in the Word of the Lord, and then at the end of that, I will put before you what I believe God has given us for the next several months. Are you glad you're a Christian this morning? Do you still love your pastor this morning? Amen. Then everybody just votes yes tomorrow night. We're okay. No. So I believe you'll be in sync with where we're at, and it's encouraging to where God's taken us. Psalms chapter number 122, if you will stand with me for the reading of God's word in prayer, and then I'm just going to preach for a little bit and get the nervousness out of it. And then when I get to a landing point, they will flip over to a Vision PowerPoint. Psalms 122, very familiar passage of Scripture. Verse number 1 says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Will you read it out loud with me? I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Can I tell you, this is not my church, it is our church. We know it's been purchased with the blood of the Lamb. It belongs to Christ. But in this passage and in this setting today, I was glad when whoever they are said to all of us, we get to come together today in the name of the Lord to lift up the name of Jesus. And my goal this morning is to build upon that and to help you understand why this needs to be your church. Let us pray. Father, we love you today. Thank you for the word of the Lord that's been read. Thank you for the atmosphere of worship, God, that I have felt in my soul this morning. The liberty, the freedom. God, we know there are many out sick today. Pray you'll bless them. Lord, those watching via the internet, touch them today. And Lord, just touch our minds. Let us be open like a sponge to receive what the Spirit of God has for us. And we will forever give you praise, honor, and glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said amen. Amen. And amen. You may be seated this morning. This is my church. Now, I don't mean mine as in Thomas Odom's church, but if you're here today under the sound of my hearing, I believe you would say with us or have a desire to say with us that this is our church or my church. And so I want to, for the next few moments, just present to you why I believe this is a church that should be more than just a church, but should be my church and your church. And hopefully we can help somebody else make it their church as well. Reminded as I was doing some reading and some studying of a young Army recruit who came to the question on his application form. The question said, what is your church preference? The young Army recruit wet the end of his pencil by placing it in his mouth and then wrote these words, red brick. What is your church preference? He answered, red brick. The church means many things to many people. It may seem as a red brick building to some, or a congregation of people for others, or it may be seen from a variety of perspectives. But only a proper usage can any place be called the house of the Lord if we're truly doing what God has called us to do. And when that building, that location, that setting becomes the house of the Lord, its worth is beyond measure. See, I'm thankful for brick and mortar, if you will. I'm thankful for a place that we can go and call our church, our building, our place of safety, our place of refuge in a physical sense. I'm thankful for the peace that this place brings to my troubled heart when I gather in these altars with you or without you and call upon the name of the Lord. But I realize that a church is much more than just a building. I realize it is much more than just programs and ministries and campuses, but it is a place where men and women can come together in like faith to call upon the name of the Lord. But it's also a place where those that don't know who Jesus is can be introduced to a man that knows more about them than they will ever know of themselves, and a man that has loved them in such a way that he gave his life for them. And I agree with the psalmist. I'm glad when they say unto me, Thomas, it's time to get up and go to church. Amen. They tell me that there's a big party going on tonight. They tell me there's a big football game going on tonight. I will tell you, I don't even think I know. I've seen a picture or two, but I don't even think I know who's playing. Can't remember. I don't even know what time it starts. I couldn't tell you that either, but one thing I do know is that if the Lord tarries, I plan to be in church again tonight because He's done so much for me. I cannot tell it all. I say, God, let us not just go through a vision Sunday, a routine, and leave with a list of projects and a list of things that some we like and some we don't, but let it burn inside of us by the Spirit of God, realizing that we have a gift that this world needs. His name is Jesus, and it's my job as the living church of the living God to give that gift to someone else. And I said, Lord, this is more than just a location, but this is a launching pad that we can do ministry for the Lord. Amen. So what is this church? What does it mean? What does it look like? Number one, my church is a door. A door. A door. What is a door? A door is something that gives us entry. If I want to access this building, it would be preferred that I use a door. Preferred. Not a window, not a new door by driving your vehicle through it, but a door. A door gives us entry. A door that gives us an opportunity to provide service for God and man. Mark 10:43, but so shall it be not among you, but whosoever is great among you shall be your minister, and whosoever will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. So Lord, let me be reminded that this place is a place that gives us an opportunity to serve the Lord, an opportunity to give back unto Him something that He's already given to us. And I said, Lord, let us realize there are no big I's and little U's at the altar of the Lord. Amen. There are no places and positions at the cross of Calvary. I realize that there's a proper order, and I'm thankful for that. I understand my responsibility very well. But Lord, my church, I want it to be just a door that gives entry for service to God and to man. A door that also allows us to have a way to access the most meaningful life that we've ever lived. What do you mean by that? The church teaches us to answer this question, what is the purpose of life? But can I tell you this morning, the purpose of life is much more than a building or a program. The purpose of my life is, after I have accepted Christ, is to give Him my everything so that He will be able to use me for the fulfilling of His gospel in this world. We cannot look at the cross and still think our lives are of no account to God. No, my friend, He became a door for you to leave the world of sin and enter into a right relationship. He became a way to Calvary, and our church needs to be that door, a door that also allows us to realize that we have a door to a future hope. I'm glad this ain't everything. If this was it, we're in trouble. Amen. But the door that brings people into Christ, I'm thankful for that door. But once we get into the family of God, I'm thankful that there is another door I'm looking for, a door called the rapture. A door that's going to lead me out of this world. But you know what? If those people that we come in contact with never find Jesus as their Savior, they will never be able to experience the rapture the way that we will experience it. I say, God, let us realize that our church is a door for bringing people in and molding them and shaping them and helping them realize that there is a blessed hope. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again into a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for us. I'm thankful for that door this morning. Number two, our church is also an armory. An armory. What's an armory? A place which supplies you with the right stuff. And our church should be an armory, a place that supplies us with the right stuff. Why do we need an armory? Why do we need a place that helps us with the right stuff? First of all, can I remind you, we're fighting evil in the world in which we live in today. And we need to make sure we know what's right and what's not right. And sometimes I need to go through the church and I need to go to the armory and I need to find out what God has for me. The church is a house of service, not a dormitory for members only. Can somebody say amen for that? It's a place I can get what I need. The church is not a tomb with a steeple, but it is a place of action. I said, Lord, let us realize that we need to put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. There is a world that is evil, and this church needs to be an armory that we can resist the ways of the evil. Secondly, in this area, it's an armory because it gives us inspiration to keep the fight, keep doing the fight, and to live what is right. Have you ever seen a world in which we're so troubled, so divided? A world where we're calling right wrong and wrong right, and if you don't agree with someone, it's just that it's not anymore that you just don't agree, but you are wrong and you need to be called. I say, God, no, we need to realize that this place needs to be a place that anybody can come to, regardless of color or background or creed, and they can meet a man named Jesus who died on Calvary for their sin. God, allow that door to lead them to an armory, which leads them to an altar where they can find a man named Jesus, and then their life will forever be changed. Can somebody say amen? It's also an armory, a place that we learn how to use our spiritual weapons. Won't read all of it, but I'll remind you, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. And because of that, we need to do some things in our life, and we need to put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to be what God has called us to be. And lastly, in this area, an armory is also a place that we can come to have a clearer vision of who Christ is. Anybody ever just get kind of unfocused in life sometimes? You do that while you're driving, you'll have a wreck. You do that too much while you're at work and you won't have a job. And sometimes in our Christian walk, that happens with the cares of life and the struggles and even the busyness, not even the bad stuff, just the busyness of life sometimes brings us to a place where we get unfocused. And by coming into the door that leads us to the armory, we can have a clearer vision of who Christ is. And number three, our church also needs to be an anchor, something that will support us in the storm. If you haven't noticed it, my friend, we're in a battle. And we're in a storm. And we need an anchor much more than Pastor Thomas and much more than this local body. And I believe I'm proper by saying an anchor that's much bigger than the Church of God. We need an anchor that is not going to give regardless of what men may say. And that's what this church needs to be. An anchor that will steady us in the storms of life. An anchor that will keep us from those that may want to destroy us. An anchor that will allow us to hold on. And if I got to just hold on to a piece of the boat, as I'm reminded in the New Testament, to make it all the way through, I believe believe if that's what God wants for me, He'll make a way. But I'm so thankful that He has told us in His Word that we can have an anchor, something that will keep us and steady us and remind us. Proverbs 11 and 14, where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. I said, Lord, I'm thankful today for a place that we can come together and call our church. That's what it is to me, a place of safety, a place of counselors. Lord, allow us to continue to be that. And number four, and lastly, in this part this morning, our church also needs to be a pilot. A pilot. A pilot to give direction and bring us safely into the harbor. I've never flown a plane. I've never had the opportunity to do that, or a helicopter. I probably could be a good helicopter pilot. Because I understand you can hit go on those things and you're gone. I probably could. Maybe I should try that as my midlife crisis. Just thought of that. A pilot. Or maybe maybe one that drives a boat. Maybe one that has to lead through some dangerous and treacherous ways of life. A pilot. Maybe our church should be a pilot, a place that guides us through difficult times. Aren't you thankful for the family of God? That when I'm hurting, they hurt with me. And when I'm crying, there'll be those that cry with me. How about a pilot, a place that in our hour of temptation, it keeps me from drifting away from God. You get these fires burning around these altars and there's something not going right in your life. The devil's tempting us. The Spirit of God can make that known. And you would have to just say no on God to walk away. God, allow our church to be a place that is like a pilot that gives direction in our hour of temptation. Let our church be a place that guides us safely into the harbor. I don't mean a physical harbor, but I mean a spiritual harbor. I said, Lord, let us be ready, for when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and the dead in Christ rise first, and then we which are alive and remain are called up to meet the Lord in the air, I want to be part of that number. Amen. And I realize it takes my relationship with Jesus being where it needs to be, but I believe we can cultivate those through the life of a church. I believe we can cultivate that through youth programs and student programs and prime timer and young adult programs, and say, look, guys, it's not about just coming together and singing a few songs and taking up a little bit of an offering and reading a few scriptures out of a book. But no, it is the living book. And if we'll allow that book to live inside of us, lives can be changed for eternity, because that's what the church is supposed to do. This is why I love my church. See, to the world, the church is responsible to preach the gospel to every creature. In regard to its members, the church is to provide ministry, support, and guidance for Christian service and for Christian living. I'm thankful this morning for my church. I don't mean my church, and I think you understand my thought there. It's not Thomas Odom's church. It was here before I got here, and it'll probably be here after I'm dead and gone. Unless Jesus comes. But it's my church. This is where I bring my family, my wife, and my three kids to instill in them what God has for them. A place that I want to be proud of. Not in the sense to be prideful, but in the sense that I can bring a neighbor or a friend and say, I know where we can find a group of people that love the Lord and lift up the name of Jesus. Our church. So on that foundation this morning, I'm going to pray. Then I'm going to ask them to transition for me, and I'm going to spend the next few moments giving you what I believe God has for us in this upcoming year. Let us pray. Father, I love you this morning. Thank you for the word of the Lord. Thank you for the hours, God, that have been put in behind the scenes to prepare us for, Lord, these few moments that we will present to your people. Lord, I thank you for staff and leadership, Lord, that have been supportive. I thank you for, Lord, just the call of God on our lives. And Lord, this church is, Lord, done so much for the kingdom of God. But Lord, there's so much more that we need to focus on as we move forward in all that God has for us. I pray you'll lead us, guide us, and direct us. And let not my will be done, but let thine will be done as we do it into the name of the Lord. And everybody said amen and amen this morning. As we transition, and again, for those that are new to our vision setting, I will now give you, in a couple different areas, a laundry list, if you will, of things on my heart, things that will be effective immediately, things that we will talk about more in detail, things that really won't change what we do, but just formalizing some things But tomorrow night, if you have questions on that, tomorrow night will be the place that we discuss that. That's why we do these back to back, and that gives you about a day and a half to kind of mull over it. If you have questions, please come see me tomorrow night at the business meeting. After we get through our financials, we will open the floor up for these type of conversations. As we move forward in this year, the Lord has really just been working on me and helping me, and there is a central theme that I want to have in the brand new year as we go from Vision Sunday to Vision Sunday, and I wanted something that would help us keep in check everything that we do. And as long as everything that we are doing is one of these areas, then we're good. If there's something that we're doing that doesn't impact one of these areas, then we need to question why we're doing it, maybe throw it out. So go ahead and let me have that theme. Our theme for this year will be pray, invite, and grow. Now, we've already begun the pray concept. Hopefully you were praying a long time before this year, amen? But just a few days ago, we strategically took a week and did some time of prayer and fasting, and we will continue to have those times together, privately and publicly, where we're going to pray. And then hopefully that prayer will encourage us to invite someone to the house of the Lord. Do you realize people will come if you'll just invite them? Amen? Most people that are born into the kingdom of God or attend a Sunday morning service, newcomers, come because somebody just said, hey, won't you come go with me to church? And I'm going to encourage us this year. We're going to pray, we're going to invite. And if we'll do those things, if we'll pray and we'll invite, we're going to leave it up to God to do the last part. But we're going to see some more growth as we do what God's called us to do. And you say, well, Pastor, this may not be for everybody, but you don't know. You don't know if you never invite them. They may come here and find Jesus as their Savior, and then God may put them somewhere, but we're still growing the kingdom of God. Amen? So you're going to see this on almost everything as the next couple of weeks as we begin to transition some of our web slides and some of our Facebooks and some of our even our bulletins. It's already on your bulletin. Anybody notice it's on your bulletin this morning? You didn't even notice it, did you? Somebody did. Okay, good. On the front of that, I think it's there. It's supposed to be there. Okay, it was there. Front of that bulletin, pray, invite, grow. That's going to be our theme for this year. And so I've challenged leaders that everything they do, now that's a pretty wide spectrum there. You can do a lot of things with pray, invite, and grow. But if they can't put it in one of those, then they're not going to do it this year. Because we're not going to do things just to have events on a calendar. But I believe that's wide enough that youth people, children people, prime-timer people can say, okay, Pastor, we're going to do this because it fits in one of these categories. And I said, Lord, let that be our theme this year. Now, one thing that we are so thankful for here on campus is we have facilities. We have a place to call church. We have a place to call home. And other churches have not been able to do that. They're having to rent or having to move in and move out every weekend, and you decided a long time ago you wanted a little place on the side of Lakewood called Ocoee Church of God. However, with the building also comes maintenance. Can somebody say amen? All right, here we go. I'm glad you're on Jesus' side this morning. Let's go. We're going to look at a couple of big things we need to challenge ourselves for this year. We have two buildings that we're going to need to replace some roofs on. The building we're currently in needs a roof replacement. And the administration building, what is also the parsonage building, needs a brand new roof. So we're looking at several tens of thousands of dollars to do that. And so you're going to be hearing more about that. Our AC building, our AC in the main building has worked fine the last 3 months. It's been quite cool in here, and I'm thankful for that. But we did struggle with it over the summer, and we're praying we can continue to hold off as long as we can. But there will come a time that we're going to need to replace that air conditioning system in this building. The one that we currently have is about 30 years old. So we're thankful it's lasted this long. But at some point, we're going to have to just bite the bullet, and we're looking, and I'll give you dollar figures tomorrow, okay? So that's another, because my job is to lead us in ministry, but we also have to take care of what we have as well. Another area I want to look at this year is a foyer bathroom remodel. Let's just go in there and gut them and freshen them up and do some new things in there. You added those buildings in the early 90s and those foyers and bathrooms in the early 90s. And we would like to just see the counters updated and the lights updated and the stalls updated. We're just going to, as God provides, we're going to do that. Installation of some handrails in the fellowship hall area. If you know where the double door is going down the ramp there, we have nice rails along the sidewalk. But I've asked Mr. B's Aluminum to come back in and finish that on down for us. So we're going to get that done as quickly as we can. And then for all the ladies and cooks in the house this morning, we're going to upgrade that stove in the fellowship hall. Amen. Everybody said amen. And if you don't cook and you eat out of that stove, you better say amen. You'll get nudged. And ladies have already been working on that. They've already told me which one they did not want and which one they do want. So I'm just waiting to go pick it up, and I need to just make sure we have time to do that. So that'll be on there. And then also a brand new freezer for our fellowship hall. We have been blessed over the last couple of years, many years now, purchased a big commercial refrigerator. We want to get a big commercial freezer that looks just like it to put right beside it to make everything match. So that's some of the facility things that we want to do this year as God opens doors. Other enhancements, and I'm going to blow through them real quickly. I want to get into the ministry stuff. But other enhancements I want to look at for this year is we will have to upgrade to a brand new phone system. We have outgrown the one we have, and I've got a couple bad ports on it, and that don't mean a whole lot to you unless you call in on that line and you can't hear us because it's staticky or it hangs up on you. And that system we've had it for about 15 years, and it was donated to us when we got it, so it's been great. It only will handle 16 phones, and I'm out of phones right now. I mean, I have nowhere to, I had to steal extensions from other places to make Modular 4 work, but we'll have a brand new phone system hopefully in the summer, maybe before the summer. Some of this stuff also our school will be very instrumental in helping us do, and we'll share those details tomorrow night. For safety and security reasons, we are looking at installing closed-circuit television cameras in our classroom and hallway areas. That is for multiple things. That is for protection of you, and that is for protection of our students. We live in a very, let's just say everybody doesn't play by the rules and doesn't play nice. And so this will give us some extra security about things in our buildings and some protection for students and staff, whether it be church or school. Automated bell system, help us with some of our scheduling around here with Sunday school classes, Wednesday night programs, and during the school. I've had this next one on my list for a couple of years. I'm just going to bite the bullet and do it. And if I run short at the end of the year, I told leadership, if I run short by this figure, I'm coming to them and receiving an offering from them. But go ahead. We're going to upgrade that camera back there. That camera actually was a Mother's Day gift to Sister Wendy about 15 years ago. And when we came to be your pastor, we put it on that tripod for one service, and it stayed there basically since then. She reminds me that that is her camera on that tripod. And I said, baby, we won't even use it at home anymore because now everybody uses their phones. She said, it doesn't matter. I just want you to know you took my camera. What it is I did not ask permission, men. So I'm going to, I've wore it out, or I have allowed technology to go by leaps and bounds. And so we need to fix that. If you've ever watched our services, we used to have some jumping issues. People would jump around stage, and it wouldn't be the Spirit of God at all. That was good, man. I just put that in there. That was good. We fixed that with our internet speed upgrade when our school went over to fiber optic lines. But the camera is only the camera. It only will be as pretty as the camera can handle. And so I'm going to spend the money. I'm just going to tell you, today it's $600 to do it. It's minimal compared to what we do. And I'm not sharing numbers for everything. But if you feel led to write me a check for that today, I can give Sister Wendy back her camera tomorrow, okay? But that will help us. We're using that for so much. Our youth choir and our dramas and some of our school programs, and we want it just to be the best. And so I don't want to do it halfway. I want to do it right. New drum set, whether we're doing electronic or a box or something, this thing that these guys are, it was wore out when we bought it used, and it's doubly wore out now. So we're going to look at some options over there. Our bus and vans need to be upgraded. Anytime we do a youth function or a school function or a church function, our little 15-passenger van ain't big enough for nothing anymore. And so we got to figure out what we're going to do. We do have the big yellow school bus, but some of my prime timers and adults don't want to ride the big yellow school bus. I don't know why. I drive it. So we're trying to figure out what is the best to make it work for the most. So what can we do that will cover a lot of ministries, whether it be children or youth or school or prime time? What can we do? So these are some pretty steep things we want to do this year, and all of it comes with a cost, and we're trusting the Lord for that. As He provides, we will do it. Now, in mentioning vans, and anywhere we go now, we're renting at least two vans. We went to Baldwin a few weeks ago, rented two vans. We went to convention this weekend, rented two vans. But vans is great. When you put people in those vans, that's wonderful. But if you're taking luggage with you, it's a problem. And because girls and boys like to pack a whole lot more than they need. Used to we would say the girls did that, but I've seen some boys pack more than girls pack, and we're only going to be gone for like two nights. So we have a desire to purchase, hopefully used in good quality, a cargo trailer. If you know of one, like a 6x12, a single axle, double axle would be better. But something that we can then put either behind a van that we own or will own, or even behind my pickup truck. It can go, I don't care. And we can put that luggage and stuff in there, and then they can have every possible seat in the van for people, because we are, you know, we are moving 25 to 40 people almost with every type of function we do for the youth group and for others. So that's an idea. Another area we want to look at is a new basketball pad and a volleyball pad on the property out back. That would primarily be just a big, flat, open concrete area that we can set up the basketball goals and the volleyball poles and use it for other events, but big enough that it will be able to do that primarily for extracurricular activities, whether it be school or youth. All right, next slide. I'm doing great on time. 12:15 will be here in just a few moments. Let me hurry. Ministry. These are areas of ministry I want us to look at doing more with this year. This one's a carryover from last year, and it's a worship pastor. And I think we called it a music pastor last year. And we didn't have a youth pastor on our list last year, but we ended up with a youth pastor, okay? We're thankful they're here. We love them. We're not going to kick them out yet, okay? And they've done a wonderful job. But our goal into last year was a music pastor, a worship pastor, someone that will be able to lead our morning worship and evening worship services with our praise team. They would be responsible for playing and things of that nature. Miss Wendy is not trying to get out of it. She's just, we just feel that's where our church is at, and we need someone that can dedicate their calling to that and work with our band and our musicians and our singers. And it looks like we're working with numbers now, but we may be able to be very creative in salary for them and housing for them. And they'll be able to hopefully have a position in our school to assist with some music there as well. So this is a big area again for me this year. It was a huge, huge step to bring on a husband and wife and three kids as a youth pastor. But so far, so good. God's blessed us, and things are going well. And this is an area that I believe would just help finish our Sunday morning. I don't like to use the word worship experiences because I think we get not too careful, we get too carnal with that stuff. But our times that we come together to lift up the name of Jesus. I called them church when I grew up. And Sunday morning, Sunday night, maybe even some Wednesday night responsibility. But help us in some areas just to make this setting as good as it can be, where the Spirit of God can touch someone's heart. And the ultimate desire is they find themselves in an altar of prayer, giving their heart to Jesus. And so then, and if you've been in church any time at all, you know music will either enhance your service or, honey, it will kill it deader than a doornail. And so we're not, you know, and I'm very selective. You know our style, and God's going to meet that need. But that's an area we want to go. Young adult, did I skip something? I did. Okay, let's go back and catch that up. Because this one won't make sense. I'm not even following my own notes. Go back to slide three. I'm sorry. I just get so excited. Go ahead. She's thinking. She say something's not right here. I skipped the whole back page of this. That's why. Forgive me. I'm nervous this morning. Elders and all that stuff I said, put it on pause. Pretend like this is the second slide, okay? Elders and trustees. I should have done this first. Oh, Jesus, help me. Elders and trustees. As you know, several years ago, we instituted elders in our church that also served as our trustees. And I am required by the minutes to have trustees available in case we ever need to buy or sell property. I move them from just trustees to elders, people that are of spiritual caliber, that can also help serve with visitation. I can go and talk to in times that I need instruction and that you feel comfortable with as being as being over you in the Lord, that you could you know, call upon them if needed. And we've had for several years we had three, Brother Holly and Sister Holly. Brother Holly's been promoted on to heaven. Brother Summerall and Sister Summerall. Brother Summerall's been promoted on to heaven. And Sister Summerall still continues to serve, and we will continue to recognize her as the elder's wife. Brother Charles Maynard and Sister Joanne, great people. If you don't know the Maynards, you just have missed out. But Brother Maynard is just not able to be with us. And then Pastor Renfro and Sister Renfro have done a wonderful job. And so they're staying. They're not leaving us. I didn't even ask. I just said Brother Renfro will stay as a trustee. He didn't say no, so I'm assuming I'm okay. And he saw it Monday night. So trustees, Brother and Sister Renfro will continue to serve as elders. Brother Renfro will serve as a trustee and an elder for us. But I need to add a couple more. So I think with our growth and where we're at with staffing and in ministries, it's just proper, I think, at this point. And I've talked to these gentlemen briefly to ask Pastor Ricky and Pastor Dustin to serve as the other two trustees at this point. What they will do in the event that we ever have to vote as a church to buy and sell property, somebody has to go sign the paperwork, and that's not the pastor. And so these guys are close, and they're on campus every day, and so it just makes it easier. And they are someone that I believe from a spiritual level you would be comfortable with going to your hospital room and praying with you. You calling upon, if you can't get me or I'm out of town, you have a tragic event in your family and need them to meet you at the hospital, you want someone that can give you some spiritual guidance and help as well. Now, I realize Pastor Dustin has only been with us for a few months, but he's proved himself already, and I think this is a great step for him. So I am recommending we add Ricky and Dustin to what we call elders trustees for our church. Brother Maynard will continue to have the title as trustee as long as he is with us and on this side of heaven. And he has done just had a great heart for ministry. If you happen to know him, you know he loves this church, but he is just physically not able. And they've told me years ago that I could do whatever I needed to do, and I just kept saying we're not doing anything, and we're not today. He is still an elder, but I will move his title to elder emeritus, if you will, which means he'll continue to keep that title, but he will have no responsibility or no obligations. His health is just not allowing him to do that. Does that make sense to everybody? And I think that's good. So that's where we're going. Now let me get into leadership and staffing updates a little more, because it'll make sense, and we can pick that slide back up. There are some staff changes that are coming that you may want to be aware of, and some of them will happen a little later on this year. But in order to prepare for that now, I am changing Christy's title from administrative assistant just to executive assistant. That'll boost her up a little bit in the world. And here's why. Rebecca served as my admin assistant for many years, and we promoted her to executive assistant just to ensure that as she moved into that process, she had the understanding of what I expected. And there's just some things in our office that are very very confidential, and with that comes a great load of confidentiality from a church perspective, maybe even a school perspective. If you saw my appointment in the bulletin this morning, I have a new real role in the state of Florida that I'm working with now with the prayer side, and we'll get involved with some very detailed things there. Our school, our region churches, sometimes we deal with pastor changes and things. So I have to make sure I protect myself, but I can't do everything. So Christy's title will be changed from admin assistant to executive assistant. It'll make more sense in just a moment why you have to have that structure. The second change we're doing is Miss Rebecca, Rebecca Smith, as many of you know her, will officially, as of tomorrow night, be considered our Journey Young Adult Pastor. Okay, Journey has kind of went just open the last several months, and she started a college and career class a few months ago. That was all intentional. It has gone well, and so we're taking that college and career class, we're taking this Journey Young Adult program, and we're merging them together, and she is now officially our Journey Young Adult Pastor, effective tomorrow night. I say tomorrow night because that'll be the official setting that I will ask you to say yes to that. And I don't think anybody have a problem. It's already on your bulletin this morning. How many of you noticed that change this morning? Good. That's another one you didn't catch. Do y'all read your bulletins? You don't read the back of them, do you? There's another change on the back of that bulletin too I'm going to get to. So if you want to get your bulletin out and not pay attention to me and read it real quick, you might can answer yes to the next question. But she will take that on, and she'll get with her group and make that happen. Amplify. Miss Tegan is our Amplify, our children's pastor. For the last several months, Hannah has been helping her. Hannah will transition out of there at the end of February, first Sunday of March. Miss Tegan's husband will be her new assistant. And they come to me several months ago and had asked if Brendan could help her back there in Children's Church. And I have no problem with that. It's a great ministry opportunity. If you can go work with kids on Sunday morning, power be unto you. Amen. And I think just with all the transition, it was best we got through the holidays. And they've got this wedding coming up in a few weeks. And so I said, look, guys, let's just get through all of that. When you come back from your honeymoon ready to take the world for Jesus, there'll be 17 kids waiting for you on Sunday morning. And so and that's something we work with Hannah and with her family. And so all that's in order. But I wanted you to know that as of the first Sunday of March, Brendan will come off the platform on Sunday mornings. We'll go to Children's Church and be involved with that ministry, and then back on the platform Sunday nights and Wednesday nights to do what he's been doing. And then I've already mentioned our worship pastor. We'll find somebody, and if they can't sing hymnals the way we sing them, then they can't come work for us. Amen? Because I guess I still make them up as I go, what some of you tell me. I sing them wrong. That's okay. It works. All right, now, Miss Rebecca, let's go back to where we were. So now, ministry, now you understand why that's there. That is something we want to make better this year. I've already mentioned young adults. We want to make it even better this year. We got a lot of kids in our youth group that are 17, 18, 19 years of age. They're going to be transitioning, and we don't want to lose them. I mean, God's done some wonderful things in our youth group, and we don't want to lose them just to the black hole. So we're going to try to intentionally have something that they can connect with, because that's a real big thing now. And so putting a person to that, I think, will help us. Let me find where I'm at now. Connecting guests is our next part of ministry. You remember a few months ago we began the teenage greeters at the front door, and then we added the connection cards, and then we added the mugs, and we added the orange bags. If you're a first-time guest, you should get an orange bag. All of that is part of this connection track. The next part of it is creating what we're calling 101, 201, 301. It's a couple of classes that we hopefully, these new families, and if you're new to our church, you're part of this, we'll be able to plug into on maybe Sunday mornings or Wednesday nights, and you can learn more about the Church of God, and you can learn more about how we operate. And because the hardest thing that I deal with sometimes is people say, I want to get involved. Well, where do you want to work at? And are they ready to work? Do they know who Jesus is? Just because it comes in and goes through a service, do we even know if they're saved? That's a huge thing for me. And then all the legal stuff we have. So there has to be a better way. We do a good job. Office, I drive the office crazy because I'm all used to make sure you get the background check turned in. Okay, we've got to put it in a way that we make it where it can just do more people at one time and make it very, very friendly. And we want to do that, and hopefully at the end of that process, they'll become members of the Church of God, and they'll already have to prove themselves with tithes and offerings, and have already been able to publicly give their testimony about how they know Jesus. I mean, all that's important. You don't want folks leading you as adults or kids if they not even know who Jesus is. And I'm afraid sometimes we jump the gun sometimes and put people in positions that are not ready to be leaders. And we'll make sure that we continue to monitor that. And that's the next part of this whole connecting guest concept. Another area, we're proud of our church and what God's doing. And so for your buying pleasure today, we have brand new I Love My Church shirts. Some of y'all wanted new ones. And so they're already here. There's 50-something of them back there. So they're $10 each for adult sizes and $8. Is that correct? $8 each. It's in your bulletin, I think, this morning as well. Did you read that in the bulletin? Fantastic. I see what pages y'all read in the bulletin. And so Miss Christie has them. If we run out of your size, that's fine. Just go ahead and pay her. She'll make a list. We'll order again this week, okay? We have them here. And the nice blue, they have the Ocoee Church name. And we want to represent. Because if we're going to pray and invite, they need to know where we're going, right? It's the way to do it right there. Very easy, very, very, very easy to do that in the community. Life groups, which is Sunday school classes and Wednesday night programs, we want to continue to enhance them and continue to have teacher training. That's an area that I think we are weak in. And so as God allows us, we want to do some more with that. The last thing on this slide is a youth group concept, I do believe. And there will be a youth name change. And I told them they had to wait at least 6 months before they changed anything as far as names, because I wanted to make sure they didn't leave us after changing the name. And but there will be a name change, and I'll give that to you in just a moment. And we're working with Pastor Dustin to implement what we're calling student leaders. These are going to be 17, 18, 19-year-olds that are still in the youth group, but are connected with our church and show some potential of maybe being a student leader, that we can help begin to mold them now before they transition out of youth group and don't know what to do with their life and with church. So there are some requirements, and he and I are working on that, but your students may start talking about that. And of course, a 13 or 14-year-old is probably not ready to be a student leader in a youth group yet, but hopefully by the time we get to 17, 18, 19, there's some maturity level there we can begin to work with and help them. I have the logo, Rebecca. I think next, if you'll go ahead and show that, they will be considered TUFF, T-U-F-F, Youth Ministries. And TUFF stands for Teens United for the Fight. Okay, Teens United for the Fight. Teens United for the Fight. So that'll be their new logo. That'll go up on Facebook and website and T-shirts and whatever they got to do. I said you can do whatever you want to do as long as you pay for it, okay? And so that'll be their new logo. And I think their youth group has been made aware of some of that. We were just waiting for Vision Sunday to make it official. So that is youth group. We will continue to do Seed for Souls this year. Seed for Souls is where we ask individuals in our church to give an extra $5 every week in your offering. You can mark it as offering or Seed for Souls. $5 every week in addition to your tithes to help us just compensate and to ensure we have no deficiencies in our operating fund. And so we'll continue to see that happen this year. It'll be in your bulletin as well. This year, we're also hoping to do the talent campaign. The talent campaign is out of Matthew 25, and the Lord gave one servant 5 talents, and one servant 3 talents, and one servant 1 talent, and I'm paraphrasing, and he went away, and a couple of them went out and did some work with it. He came back, and they had increased their talent, but that one took his and buried it in the ground, and the master was not happy with him. The master said, you should have at least went out and used your talent, used what I've given you, and when I come back, bring it back to me with some usury or some sweat equity in it. So our talent campaign we're looking at doing later this year is where we will give you talents. In the past, we have taken about $2,000 out of our church funds, and we've divided up into 100 envelopes ranging from $1 to $100, and we just give everybody an envelope on Talent Sunday. And your job is to take that talent, whatever you get that Sunday, and use it for the next several weeks and bring it back on Miracle Sunday, at least with usury. Don't be like that servant that buries that envelope for whatever time frame it is and bring... No, no. Use that for something for the kingdom of God. The goal is it'll be returned with usury, but hopefully it'll return with an increase. And that's Miracle Sunday, and it's a wonderful way to celebrate God's goodness. And we'll talk more about that later. Easter's coming up. We will do a big old Easter extravaganza again on Saturday. And we're looking at maybe even a Good Friday night service. And then Sunday morning, Easter Sunday morning, where we'll have worship service here. We are concerned about the crowd, and we're already working on how to fix that. So you'll hear more about Easter in just the coming few weeks, probably about another month, because we are definitely concerned about the Easter crowd already. Our crowds are up, and we're thankful for that. Where are we going next? I think it's this page. I want to make sure I'm on the right page. Go ahead. Yes, okay. With the placement of Building 4, we're at the point now, our Wednesday night classes are too large for the rooms in the administration building. We're cramming 8, 9, 10, 12 girls in those rooms. It's just way too much. So we're going to need to look at utilizing the modulars, all 4 of them, for Sunday school and Wednesday night programs. Okay, here's the challenge with that. I need some help, because we're going to have to tear down some things and set up some things on Wednesday night after church and sometime over the weekend. And you don't have to have, I can use anybody probably in this building. Okay? I just need some help, because I can't do it. Pastor Ricky can't do it. Pastor Dustin can't do it. They already we tear down. Coach Rob can't do it. We tear down Fellowship Hall twice a week already. And we're not going to go quite that extensive, but we need to put up some things and make sure classrooms are back in order. That way when you come to school on Thursday, you're not walking into a class that has been trashed. That would not make me happy as a teacher. And so, but we don't want those buildings to continue to sit there. We use them every day, but we need to use them more for Sunday school and Wednesday night. So we'll be hearing about that. And then another short-term goal is we need to find out how to make some more room for church. We are at capacity. We're well over the 80% every week in this building. We realize that you have been so faithful and so loving to us, and you're so forgiving, but everybody's not going to do that, and we're at that point again. We got to do something. So that's a short term. Long term goals, and I've heard your cry. I know you want a commercial kitchen. I know you want a new fellowship hall. I know you want a new something, okay? It's on the list. I've put it all together, and I've called it this: a family life center gymnasium with commercial kitchen. I think that covers everybody for right now. And that is a long-term goal. And tomorrow night I'll share some numbers with you. I have that information if you want to know what we need and some thoughts there. Wouldn't it be nice to have all of that? But we've got to get there, and God's going to help us in His time. I call it long-term because the short-term goals I want to do like this year, and I'm not sure we can get a building built in the next 11 months. If you have the money, we will. We'll try. That's why I'm calling them long-term, but it is a need, and we're going to talk about how to do that. The last slide that I have, and then I'm going to pray, and you're going to go home, and please don't have preacher for lunch today, okay? The last slide I have is regarding what is our largest ministry out, you know, in the church as far as not Sundays, if you will, and that's our school. A couple things going to happen in our school. Effective March 1st, Rebecca is officially being promoted. We'll take care of it tomorrow night in a business meeting, but officially being promoted to principal. You've already heard that. Did anybody see that change on the back of the bulletin? That was the other one. We dropped the word assistant principal and just made it principal. It'll be effective as of March 1st. She already has a brand new sign for her door. It says principal. Current enrollment, if you don't know, we're at 93 students right now on campus. And we're looking to be if we keep the same layout for next year, we're looking to be somewhere around 112. Is that correct? 110. 110 for next year with current layout. We're already in the re-enrollment process. We already have parents that are coming in right now and re-enrolling for next year. Open enrollment for our school begins March 1st. So if you know anybody that wants to get in for next year, they need to, March 1st, they need to be on the phone, because I'm telling you, we are already realizing we're going to have limited openings if everybody comes back next year, okay? So they just need to call March 1st and talk to Rebecca and get on her list. My new words are, I'm not sure anymore. That's Miss Rebecca's job. Go ask her. The next part of our school, and this word will be a little bit different for us, is we're now at the point where we're ready to expand the K-4 program, which is our VPK program, and add K-3. So expand four-year-olds and drop down to the three-year-olds and move them to the youth pastor's house. They're going to watch kids all day long. No, they're not. No, they're not. But we're at the point with a budget perspective, and we're looking at the options to where we will, as you know, when Pastor Dustin came on, the school took the mortgage payment for that house. Prior to that, the renters were paying it. But with them coming on, the school took care of the salary for Miss Holly and took care of the mortgage payment for the youth house. The church takes care of the utilities. We are going to ask them to relocate. We will help them secure a place in the area. The school will continue to pay for that for them, as we're doing now. But in addition to that, the school will also be able to utilize that location on 16th Avenue right back here. It'll be expanded for K-3 and K-4. We're anticipating about 30 to 35 kids in that building. That will bring our overall enrollment capacity up to about 135 or 140. At that point, that is big enough. Okay, at that point, we just can't really do anymore. I've already spoken with the county, and they are very favorable of that, to the point that we go before them on March the 2nd, I think it is, to be heard as a special exception. And their words to me were, it makes sense just to expand it over. It's part of the same campus. We won't have to do a a whole lot of parking over there because we have enough parking on this campus. One office, one phone number, everything works together, all connected, and they are very supportive of that and said, y'all have done a great job. We get no complaints, knock on wood, no complaints from your neighbors, and the way we fix that is we just put church people in these houses over here, and then if they fuss, we tell them to pray through before they call the county. And no, we have great neighbors. We have great neighbors, and the resident right behind our property, Benjamin and Marina, they bought that house. They work for us in our school, and so that keeps that down. And then Travis over on the other side over here, he's a great guy, and he's been very supportive of our church and us being here. So we just believe this is the next step. This is a huge step. This is a huge step because with this, it's going to require some additional staffing. If we make this transition, Miss Wendy will officially be over K3, K4, and Miss Sonia will continue to have a role in our VPK program, but we're going to have to add some staff members to fill in those other gaps, daycare staff. Daycare will run full year. It won't close for the summer. It'll be a full year program. It will run every day of the year except for 4th of July, Christmas, Labor Day. I mean, it's a daycare facility. We're at that point where we're ready to do that to give us the kids to continue to minister to. It will require some additional staff additions. And the last thing I'm going to say on this, we'll talk about more tomorrow night, is we will have to update our policies to reflect some of these changes. Let me tell you the biggest one that we will discuss tomorrow, and probably the only one tomorrow night, is in all of the years we've had the school, I have served as your pastor and principal and the chairman of the school board, okay? And our elders board has served as your school board. Well, you could do that when you were small. The challenge is now I cannot continue to operate as principal and pastor for reasons that I think are obvious, so we have to make sure that we fix that. And we're going to do that tomorrow night in our business meeting. What I don't want you to do is I don't want the church to ever be in a position, okay, and this ain't going to happen as long as I'm here, but guys, I could die tomorrow. I don't ever want to put you in a position that you are going to have a difficulty between your pastor and your principal. See what I'm saying? It'll make this place a nightmare, okay? I believe you have a good principal, and I hope I'm a good pastor, and Rebecca's grown up under our ministry here. I'm thankful for that. But none of us are guaranteed tomorrow. So in the business meeting, leadership got this Monday night, we will strategically change a policy in our school handbook that says the principal is over the school, school board does what school boards have to do. We have to, by law, do that. However, it is a ministry of this church. The pastor sets in on all the meetings. And at any time the pastor feels the school board is not making the decision that's in favor of the ministries at large, the pastor, by virtue of his position, will make the decision based on what's best for the entire ministry, not just for school. Okay, and you say, well, that seems elementary in our current setup. It may be, but I'm not talking about just today and tomorrow. If Jesus tarries 15 more years from now, I may not be your pastor, and I don't want you to say then, oh, well, I thought we handled that. We're going to handle it early to protect us going forward because the buck's got to stop with someone, and I have no problem with it stopping with me. But we got to do that. I can't just say I'm pastor. I could go to Rebecca and influence her today and say, I think we need to do this. She will respond to that. But who's to say what will happen in 10 or 15 years? And we want to make sure on paper that we're set up that the school is a religious operation from the church, and it does operate with the school board and with policies, and they have their own checkbook and everything, but it's same tax ID number, and the pastor will make the final decision because he is responsible for everything. Sunday school, youth programs, prime timers, all up. Make sense? So we'll fix that tomorrow night. Stand with me. I've kept you too long. And are you excited?
Yeah.
It's encouraging. It's a lot of work. Now you say, I can't remember all this. I didn't ask you to. If you will see Miss Christie on the way out, she has these printed for you. And you can pick up a hard, it's just a photocopy, but you can pick up a copy of it on your way out where you can pray over it and muddle over it with me. If you are going to be here tonight, which I hope you are, and we run out, will you get yours tonight? We'll make more copies this afternoon. Let us pray, and you can go. Father, thank you for a great day. Thank you for what you're doing in our church and our ministry. Lead us in all we do. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you. See you back tonight.